Why don't I just get started?
Yeah, good.
And,
good idea.
If the AV catches up, it will. So how many of you saw my presentation this morning?
Yeah.
A couple people? All right. So one of the things I said in my presentation is that I never repeat a presentation. And then the organizer said, oh, well, we've got this other a presentation this afternoon. And so fortunately, I met Mario about an hour ago. And he told me about Vagas. And how many people here work for this company? Okay, so a few Vagas employees. And then I guess the rest of you are customers or looking for jobs or in some way interested in what Vagas is doing. Because when Mario told me what was what they were doing, it was really fascinating because it's very similar to a new initiative that I'm pursuing right now in the United States. It's a nonprofit, so most of my companies are for-profit, but I ran across a problem, and it turned out that the appropriate solution in this case was to build a nonprofit. And so this is what I'm doing these days. And I thought it would be much more interesting to take this, especially in light of the presentation that I gave before. So I'm from Silicon Valley. I also live in St. Louis, Missouri, which is in the center part. And they're very, very different cities. So in Silicon Valley, one of my friends had a birthday party recently. And she turned an easily divisible number and decided that she wanted to have a big birthday party. So we go to her birthday party, and about halfway through, she says, oh, I've got a surprise for you. I wanted to have a band at my birthday party. So I got Maroon 5. And literally, with fewer people than are in this room, Maroon 5 takes the stage. And now, Maroon 5 is probably the most popular band in the world right now. They're on a world tour, and they have everything set for this giant show. Right? And with 50 people in the audience, it's totally inappropriate because they've got these long pauses, which makes sense if you've got 50,000 people in a stadium and everybody's screaming. And if you've got, you know, 12 introverted geeks taking selfies, it's no good. So you can't take the big show. So I've created an entirely different thing, but I want to also involve you in this because the presentation that I am now going to give to you, or maybe you'll get to see, was created spontaneously, but I'd like to have at least as much of an interaction with possible with the audience, because I don't know a lot about what your interests and needs are. So what I thought I would do to sort of stimulate conversation, because we have Q&A afterwards, is talk about this journey that I'm currently on. And not from the perspective of somebody who's completed the journey, but from somebody who is pursuing it. And it's good because there's been a lot of problems. And problems make good stories. So with that, I'll tell you how it all started. So when my son was born, he's now 5 years old, but when my son was born, my wife and I were living in San Francisco. But we decided that San Francisco was not sort of a good place to raise a kid. And I'm from a little town in the center of the United States called St. Louis, Missouri. Some of you have heard of Ferguson, Missouri. Actually, you've all heard of Ferguson, Missouri, right? All the riots and all that crap. Yeah, that's my hometown. So, but it's where my family is. So we moved back so that my son could, you know, be with his grandparents and, you know, see my friends. And it just seemed like the place to live. But at the time, I wasn't really very busy. So I started fixing up an old apartment building. And one of the guys that I was doing some of the work with was this Russian who was a tiler. So he set tiles. And he came to work one morning and told me that his son had been killed, murdered, delivering a pizza in my hometown. And this was just devastating. Because, well, I mean, hundreds of reasons, but like, this guy had his son dead, and that was bad enough. But then I kept thinking about the situation that led to this, and the Soviet Union. So when he left Russia, it was not called Russia, it was called the Soviet Union, and it was a place that was terrible. And you were lucky to get out, and St. Louis, my hometown, was actually very welcoming to immigrants from the Soviet Union. And so it was his dream to get out of this place. And then he brings his son over, and my city kills his kid. So I tried to wrap my head around this, and looked at the situation around the murder, and it turned out this kid was delivering a pizza, and these three guys shot him before he got out of his car. And again, this doesn't make any sense to me, because a pizza delivery kid doesn't carry any significant amounts of money, so there's no financial motive. And because they shot Daniel before he got out of his car, well, I thought, you know, you can't even get into a fight with somebody who isn't out of their car. I could almost understand if he'd gotten to the street and something had happened on the street and somebody had a gun, and, you know, but they basically executed this guy through the window. And I just couldn't handle it. And so my wife and I, literally, my wife, so she's Swedish. She doesn't understand anything about my country, let alone our handgun laws. And I'm trying to explain this to my wife, you know, how this murder happened, but I can't comprehend. And so what I did was I fell back on this idea that these guys were crazy. You have to be crazy to kill a pizza delivery kid, because you're almost guaranteed to get caught, because it happened, you know, they drove to the guy's house, you know, so they had ways to find the guys who did the murder, and there was no money, there was no fight involved. So the only explanation I could come up with was that they were crazy. But there's a problem with that, and that is I have studied a lot of math, and I'm very good at doing math very quickly. And here's the math you have to do to explain crazy. How many, this is Brazil, you guys, not the sanest place on the planet, right? How many people are absolutely crazy in Brazil? One out of 1,000? You know, be generous. You know, you got Carnival, right? Maybe 1 out of 1,000. Like, I mean, talking kill a stranger crazy. And, but if 1 out of 1,000 people, which I think is, I don't think the odds are that high, but if you say, to be generous, 1 out of 1,000 people is crazy, then the problem is, in this case, you have 3 assailants. So you take 1 to 1,000, and then you multiply that by 1 out of 1,000. Now that's 1 in 1,000,000. And then you multiply that again by 1 in 1,000. That's 1 in 1,000,000,000. So my explanation, my rationalization for this crime was that there was a 1 in 1,000,000,000 chance that my explanation made sense. Statistically, that's what I had to come back with. And so, of course, I know I'm wrong. But all I know is that I'm wrong. I don't have any sense of why. So I drove to this part of my city, which was, it's just heartbreaking. I drove there, and I looked around, and I saw what was happening, what that environment looked like. And I tried to put myself in the frame of mind of somebody who had grown up there, for whom that was their life. And I can't say that I accomplished anything, but I at least thought about the fact that maybe if I had grown up in this part of my town, maybe I would think differently about taking another life. And I don't know, I never quite figured that out, but that was what led me into this very, very dark period where I was crying all the time. I was pretty messed up. And I was trying to figure out what you could do, because I felt powerless. I felt like there was nothing I could do to fix this situation. This is my hometown. And I have a lot of resources these days. But I felt like I couldn't do anything about it. Meanwhile, as I'm feeling this way, I then got I'm still at Square, right? I'm still involved with Square. Square is a company. We're about to go public. It's been a huge success. We get, you know, thousands of employees. And at the time, we were hiring people as quickly as possible if they were programmers. And I thought about this, and I thought, I wonder if it would be possible to take these programming jobs, which are pretty good jobs, and make them available in some way to the people who were in this neighborhood. And I just thought about that for a little bit. And then, as luck would have it, I was invited to give a speech. Somebody asked me to talk. And I'm a real booster for my hometown. So I'm not a guy that usually sits, you know, stands up there and depresses an audience. Sometimes it happens. And they asked me to give this speech literally while I'm in the midst of dealing with Daniel's death. And all the important people from my hometown are there, all these rich, very powerful people. And they were expecting this feel-good speech about St. Louis, and that's not what I gave them. I gave them the most appalling statistics. We are the fifth most segregated city in the United States. We're not even a top 100 city anymore, but we are number 5 when it comes to segregation. We are really good at separating this group from that group. And segregation actually benefits the people on one side of the line. And we've gotten very good at it in my hometown. And so basically, in an hour-long speech, I just beat the crap out of my neighbors. And I said, we have to do something, and I have an idea, because I didn't want to just leave them all depressed. I said, I have an idea, because I know something about programming, because I'm a programmer. And I wrote my first textbook on programming when I was 19 years old. It was published. This was before the days you could self-publish. Everybody's like, I got a book now. Yeah, you self-publish. I know. Doesn't count. Back in 1987, I wrote my first programming textbook. And at the time, I had not studied computer science. But it turns out that programming is something that you can learn really, really fast. It's not that hard to learn. And I'd learned it well enough in the course of 6 months to be able to write a book on the subject, which then became a bestseller, and then I got another book on the subject, and that's actually how I got sucked into computer science. It was by writing about the subject. So I knew, I had this secret knowledge that it's not that hard to be a programmer. I also knew that at least the companies in Silicon Valley didn't care what the credentials were for the people we were hiring. We were hiring literally at Square people who were out of high school. No college degree, no college at all. My partner, Jack, never graduated from college. Bill Gates didn't graduate from college. Zuckerberg, no, like in Silicon Valley, we do not care what your pedigree is. And so what I did in the speech was I said, maybe we can figure out a way to take people, train them, and put them in these jobs. Because there was a failure in the market. And I knew this because there had been a disconnect between supply and demand. So I used an example. Oh, hey, look, it works. Thanks, guys. Hand for the tech team. Wait, don't applaud yet. No, it doesn't work yet. That's not that important. All right, if you can get that to advance. Oh, all right, okay, there we go. So there we go. That's a great slide. We could just make the whole presentation about this slide. So there was this giant failure, okay? And the failure was in the economy. Because we had all these great jobs, and we had people who needed these great jobs, but somehow it wasn't working. And I couldn't figure out why the economy was failing. But I was sitting home, and I thought, maybe there's something I could do. Like, maybe, what can one person do? And I thought about not what I could do, but like, what would a solution just in general look like? What are the components of a solution? And I thought that the components would be, first of all, that it was scalable, right? That if you were going to fix this problem, it couldn't be just one or two people. It had to be hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands. So we would need to have something that was accessible by lots and lots of people. It also had to be something that was economic, because I don't believe that charity really works that well. Charity works as long as everything's good, right? And then, you know, your currency loses half of its value overnight, and all of a sudden, guess what cut? You know, charity. So the solution had to be something that was economic. It also had to be accessible to the people that we wanted to reach, In other words, you didn't need to have some sort of crazy academic or social or any credential to participate. And then the final thing that I thought for a solution was it had to be fast. And it had to be something that would come quick enough that I could see a measurable change. And so with this in mind, I gave this talk. And the talk had this effect. Actually, it was a hell of a talk. I don't usually worry about getting beaten up by my audiences. But in this case, there was so much chaos in the room. One guy passed out. I'm not kidding. One guy collapsed. The cameraman stopped recording the speech to deal with the guy that passed out. I kept talking, and hands were going up in the room saying, we want to help, we want to do something. By the end of the speech, I had 30 people, like audience volunteers, and I did not ask for volunteers. They were just like, I want to do something. They were interrupting me. It was actually awesome. And they ended up asking, they wanted to implement the solution, and the solution was very simple. I said, let's start a training program and get people from the other side of the tracks trained as coders. And the result of this was a group that wanted to do it, but at the time I was not involved with this group. I was off doing some other stuff with Square, and so I told them everything I wanted to do, set them off, and nothing happened. So once again, we were stuck with failure. But then I was invited, quite by chance, to open a Ruby class. Now, those of you who use Ruby on Rails, some of you guys know what that is. It's a programming language. It's not that special. It happens to be in demand right now in the United States, and we have a shortage of Ruby programmers in St. Louis. And some of my friends called me, and they said, we want to start a Ruby school. Will you help us? And I said, it's probably not going to work. And the reason I gave was that the criterion for success in teaching is different than the criterion that I was using. And by that, I mean this. I said to the group, even if you teach Ruby and do a perfect job, the graduates of this class are not going to get hired by the companies because the companies won't respect your credential. What, so you're going to open St. Louis Ruby Academy? Nobody's heard of that. And even if the education is good, nobody's going to respect that credential enough to give somebody a job. So it's not going to work. And at this point, I thought about this speech that I'd given a year before and how, you know, people had wanted to change the world, but nobody had actually done anything. I said, you know, guys, look, if we really want to do something, forget the Ruby class. What we really need to do is change the way employers behave. And it's never been done before. And that's what we should be doing. And to my surprise, all three of these guys said, I want to help. And so instead of starting a Ruby class, we started this thing called Launch Code. And this is our early team. This is Brendan Lynn. He's now the executive director of Launch Code. Zach and a guy named Ryan. Ryan is almost 7 feet tall. And this is a Pointosaurus pizza. It's that big. The company that makes this pizza will pay you $500 if you and a friend can consume it in under an hour. But what we did at Launch Code was revolutionary because we decided to start with the employers and see if we could change the attitudes of the employers. And I was lucky because Square had given me a lot of status in St. Louis. So I could call anybody. And I literally called the CEOs of every significant company in my town. Monsanto, Anheuser-Busch, Boeing, Enterprise Rent-A-Car. And the calls went like this. I'd call up Andy Taylor. Andy runs Enterprise Rent-A-Car. Enterprise is the largest rent-a-car company in the world. And I'd say, Andy, how's it going? He's like, Jim, what do you want? I said, well, tell me how your IT department's treating you. He says, you know the answer. They're treating me like crap. Like Zipcar's breathing down our neck. We need to get a problem. We need to, you know, get products out the door. And we can't do this because I don't have enough programmers. We have 200 open jobs, but I've only got 20 positions advertised because I can't even fill those 20. So why advertise all the 200? You know. And then I called Boeing, and they needed 700 people. And so to each of the CEOs, I said, I got a deal for you. I'm going to give you a qualified person that I will vouch for. I will test them. I will make sure that he or she is qualified before I send them to you. But you don't have to trust me. Just pay them $15 an hour, which even in the United States is a very low wage, $15 an hour. And you could fire them after the first hour. You can fire them after the first day. You can keep them 6 months. I don't care. Just give them a try. And they said, what's the catch? I said, there's no catch. He said, what if we want to hire them full time? I said, I would encourage you to do that. And so with this as the come on, I signed up every employer in town. Now, I say every employer. I stopped at 100 because after 100 employers, we identified 5,000 open jobs. And no employer ever said no to the offer. So we had the employers on board as long as we could deliver the talented people. So we started looking for talent. And we quickly ran into a very interesting secondary problem. So the first problem was that employers were closed-minded, that they only would hire people with degrees. We fixed that problem. So we started looking for talent. We made this open call. I got on TV and I said, hey, if you know how to code, I don't care what your degree is. I don't care if you got a criminal record. I don't care at all. If you know how to write code, come in, I'll test you, and here are all these employers who want to hire you. 400 people showed up. We tested them. And 40 of them, so 10% of that group, were good enough that we felt we could place them. So those 40 we put out immediately, and all of those 40 people were hired full-time. So pretty big success. But then we had 360 people who wanted those jobs, but when I tested their skills, they weren't quite up to the standards. And one of them was heartbreaking. There was this lady. She was a police dispatcher from my hometown. And I don't know if you know what a police dispatcher is. This is somebody who wears one of these incredibly painful headsets, like all day long. And she sits in a dark by herself, listening to people phone in horrible problems. And she does this alone. It is a crummy job. It is a terrible job to be a police dispatcher. And guess what? She didn't want to be a police dispatcher. She wanted to be a programmer. So she decides to enroll in one of the 7 institutions in my hometown that is an accredited 4-year nonprofit bestower of computer science degrees. There are 7 of these. But when I tested her skills, she didn't know what the hell she was doing. And I had to tell her, I said, look, I'm sorry. You don't know how to use GitHub. You don't know how to use a Makefile. You don't have any current skills. I can't get you a job with what you know. And she handed me her diploma. She said, but Jim, I got an A. I got a degree. I took out a loan. I sent my kids to my ex-husband so I could have enough time working a full-time job to finish this thing. I've done it. At which point I realized the second problem, which is, and I'm only speaking for my hometown, of the 7 institutions that bestow degrees, 2 of them are good. 5 of them are worthless. Now, how do you know? And again, my wife happened to be sitting in the room while this was happening. And again, my wife is from Sweden. She doesn't understand our gun control laws. She also doesn't understand American education. The fact that we have to pay for college is sort of crazy, and I have to explain this to my wife. And my wife looked at me and she said, what was she supposed to do? She played by the rules, right? She went to an accredited university, a university that brags about their job placement. She did the work. She got an A. How was she supposed to know? And I thought about this, like, oh my God. There's no way she could know. I know the 2 that are good, but that's because I test all their graduates now. But if I was an undergraduate going in, there'd be no way I could do it. Again, huge failure. So back on the couch, trying to figure out how the hell we're going to solve this. And once again, my wife comes to the rescue. So my wife, she's pretty awesome. She's an attorney from Sweden. So, or I should say she's a recovering attorney. Because in the United States, it's not good to be an attorney. I don't know how you feel about them down here in Brazil. We don't like lawyers where I come from. And my wife, who is used to this noble profession, in Sweden, attorneys are respected. In the U.S., not so much. And so my wife gets over to the U.S. and she's like, I don't want to be an attorney here. I was like, well, what do you want to do? She's like, I want to be a computer scientist. I said, oh, great. You know, it turns out I went to Washington University, which is a great school. I got a degree in the engineering from the engineering school. Why don't you go to my alma mater? And she says, Jim, nobody's heard of Washington University overseas. I want to go to Harvard. I was like, well, all right, if you can get into Harvard, go to Harvard. So she gets into Harvard, and I'm amazed. But because we're living in St. Louis, she's taking all her Harvard classes online. And right in, well, in the middle of placing all these 40 people, and right in the middle of interviewing this, I'm watching her do this courseware from Harvard, and I discover something amazing, that the standards for this one introductory class called CS50 that Harvard University teaches, the standards are higher than the standards we were using for the 40 people that we got jobs for. So the light goes on in my head when my wife tells me that Harvard has decided to release this curriculum for free. So Harvard, through edX, has put the CS50 curriculum, which is world-class Harvard education, online for free. And I was like, oh my God, that's the solution. I don't have to ask anybody to take out a loan. They can just take the stuff online. So we we didn't ask anybody's permission. I just said, okay, we're going to have to teach a free Harvard class, and it's got to be a big class. So I got a small team together. We got three venues downtown, and we said, again, I got on TV, and I just said, okay, here's the deal. I got a free education from Harvard University, and if you finish this, if you do the work, I got over 1,000 jobs right now in town today at all these employers who want to hire you. Who wants to do this? 1,000 people showed up. Now, this is the room that we had to go to. We actually overflowed every venue that we had and had to, at the last minute, get the guy who owns the local hockey team to call in a favor and give us the concert hall where we held the first class. And this is literally the first class, and that's me on stage, and that's the that's the borrowed video projector that we had, which was woefully inadequate for 1,000 people. But it was a very interesting group, because what I said to the group was, I said, normally in a group this big that's all here to get jobs, you would have to beat the person next to you, right? You would have to do better than he does, because you're competing for the job. But I said, we have a very funny mathematical situation here, because there are only 1,000 people in this room, and I have more than 1,000 jobs open today in town. So you don't need to beat the person next to you. You need to find their email, get their home phone number, and figure out how you can work together, because guess what, guys? We don't have any resources to help you. That's 15 left? Oh, okay, great. So let's pick up the pace. All right, so great thing about Harvard, they made it available for free. There was a problem with that, and that was a free class offered the way we offered it statistically has a 1% chance of getting a student through. We have, so this is Harvard. This is the actual room at Harvard University. This is Saunders Hall. And this, if you take the class at Harvard University, you have a 99% chance of passing. And I was trying to wrestle with these statistics. And I mean, you can kind of understand it, right? Because Harvard students are very smart, right? You got to be pretty smart to get into Harvard. And then Harvard students, well, they're not holding down extra jobs, and they've got all their peer support, and they got their parents breathing down their necks, and they've probably taken out these massive loans to be able, you know, so they're pretty bought in. But Harvard had this 99% pass rate, whereas we were getting about a 1% pass rate. And so again, failure. I've got this world-class free education, right, from Harvard. I've got employers ready to hire people, but it doesn't work. It doesn't scale. It's not going to solve the problem. So then I got invited. Actually, Harvard asked me to come bring the program to Boston. So they heard about what we were doing in St. Louis. They said, hey, we got a bunch of needs in Boston. Would you move to Boston? We'll give you free office space. And they offered me $1.25 million to move the program, open up a Boston office. And I looked at it. Not that I got a problem against getting $1 million, but here's the problem. In Boston, Massachusetts, they don't have a tech talent shortage. Like, there are two cities in the world that really don't have a problem. It's Boston and San Francisco. Boston has some of the best education in the world. San Francisco has the best tech infrastructure in the world. They all have enough engineers. Their economies are not constrained the way other cities are. And if you actually rank cities from best to worst technologically in the United States, you know what the worst city out of the top 100 is? Not St. Louis. We were like 27. The absolute last place was Miami, Florida. So I went down to Miami, and I talked to the Knight Foundation. I said, if you guys will match the offer that Boston gave us to, you know, basically pay for an office and let us hire some staff, we will bring the launch code model down to you, and we will do it where it needs to be done. And in addition to this, Miami has this fantastic university called Miami-Dade College. And if you can argue that Harvard is the most selective university in the nation, perhaps in the world, you can also make a very good argument that Miami-Dade College is the least selective in the world. They admit anybody, and they're proud of it. I say this with pride when I'm on stage in Miami. They are the least selective college in the world. If you want to go there, welcome. So when I moved down to Miami, word of what we had been doing got down, and Miami-Dade College said, hey, look, we've got 8 campuses. We have 160,000 students. We want to help. And we looked at the ways they could help, and it turns out there are a lot of ways they can help. They can give us some classrooms. We didn't have classrooms when we were teaching this class. We were like, hey, go home, watch this thing online, and come in. You better find a place to meet because we don't have any place for you to meet. So, you know, we were overflowing the coffee shops and the public libraries. We didn't have classrooms. We didn't have a schedule, right? We couldn't set a schedule because we didn't have anything to schedule with. So we were saying, hey, just figure it out. Trade numbers with your neighbors. They gave us teaching assistants. They gave us regular schedules. They gave us classrooms to meet. And they were so into this that Harvard itself decided to come down to Miami. And as a matter of fact, yesterday. Yesterday, I was in Miami, Florida with Harvard. And this is David Malam. He is the guru of CS50. He is the most famous computer instructor on the planet. And David and his team were down in Miami yesterday teaching to students who would never have a chance at experiencing this education firsthand. And guess what it's done to our numbers? We're now up to a 50% pass rate. So I'm going to wrap it up here because I don't want to have to spend time on some questions, but I want to give you the numbers. Because I'm a numbers-driven guy. If you're going to do something like this, you have to respect the numbers. It's all feel good until you actually start telling the results. So what are the results? Well, we've had 250 placements to date. So we're a nonprofit. We don't count anybody who is a transfer. So if you're programming at one company and we move you to another company, you don't count. If you're working as a bus driver and then you work as a programmer, that counts. We have 250 of these to date. Half of the people that we're reaching are now unemployed. And by the way, unemployed is not the worst group to place. You want to know what the worst? Well, the worst group is actually former prisoners. That's the hardest person to get a job for, somebody who's just come out of prison. Funny story, actually, we got a job for a guy who just came out of prison. We're talking to the employer. I was like, well, what was he in jail for? And I was like, cocaine. And they're like, oh, coke. I don't know. And you know what I said to him? I said, cocaine, that's a high-performance drug. Like, it's not like he was dealing pot or something. Coke. This is a guy that wants to stay up all night working. They hired him. 50% of our people come unemployed. 40% have never had a college degree. We've had, to date, 100% employer participation. This is pretty special. No employer has ever turned down the launch code offer. It has never happened. We're talking big companies, you know, Carnival Cruise Lines, every bank, every company we talk to, every single company says yes to our offer. So we have essentially this infinite demand. 85% have no computer science degree. 90% of our people are now hired full-time. Now, this was an interesting statistic, because remember I told you at that first meeting that everybody we placed, all 40 people got hired? Well, I actually had a meeting with the staff afterwards, and I said, we got to lower our standards. They were like, what? I said, we got to lower our standards. I said, we're screening out too many people. If we are placing 100% of the people that we offer to the companies, we're not offering enough people. So let's lower the standards until it's about 90%, which is where we've been running for about the last year and a half. And then one speech from Obama. So this is what happened recently. So President Obama, as you know, or maybe not, maybe you don't know, can't get along with Congress. So he can't get any legislation passed. So he's got, like, nothing to do. And as a result of this, he's looking for things that he can do without Congress's permission. And it turns out that Megan Smith, who's the CTO of the United States, heard about Launch Code, invites me into the White House. I tell her about the program. She's like, the president is really interested in doing something. Can he help? And I was like, he's the president of the United States. Of course he can help. So about 6 months ago, President Obama stood up in front of the nation and said that Launch Code, this little project that I started in my hometown, should be the model for the United States. He pledged $100 million to support this new class of training, this new class of education, which leads to real jobs. And then he announced a 25-city initiative called Tech Hire, which is trying to accelerate what we're doing. And we're thrilled about this, because like I say, this is a nonprofit. Nobody's going to make $1 billion off Launch Code, except maybe the employers. But it's an example, and this is why I thought it would be appropriate for a conference like this, which is about problem solving and entrepreneurship, to sort of explain how it goes. Now, I put this final slide up. You know, after all these failures, I think it's finally working. I am certainly wrong about that. There will be another fail. There will be the next, oh shit, it's not going to, you know, maybe it doesn't work in certain neighborhoods or something like that. But at least right now, we've finally gotten to a state after 2.5 years of very serious work that we have something that is addressing the problem. So thank you very much. I'm really happy to take questions on this or anything I talked about before. So yeah, there we go. Oh, so we're taking the questions outside? Okay.
The audience will make some questions, and
either
I
you,
told
sir.
Them
yeah.
Is in English? All right. So,
bring it.
Quem é que gostaria de começar fazendo uma pergunta? Alguém está querendo já começar? Vamos abrir? Bom, já que as perguntas ainda não vieram, eu tenho certeza que daqui a pouco vocês começam, porque em todas as outras dinâmicas, a gente começou e a audiência ficou assim um pouquinho esperando, e depois as perguntas vieram, e a gente já teve que até encerrar antes, porque as perguntas estavam vindo sem parar, então aí vocês se animam. Eu vou começar perguntando pro Jim, se ele poderia fazer uma espécie de um paralelo entre essa crise que você relatou lá dentro, que motivou uma grande iniciativa, com o que nós estamos vivendo no nosso país. Nós estamos vivendo uma crise econômica, uma crise social.
Yes.
Você vê um paralelo? Você acredita que a gente possa fazer uma grande transformação, né, nessa nossa crise e fazer com que o nosso país saia mais fortalecido desse momento atual?
Well, yeah, absolutely. Okay. Wow, stereo. This is awesome. No. So absolutely. Look, I don't pretend to know what it's like in Brazil right now. I've read about these things, but unless you live through them. But I'll say two things. Number one, when we started Square, which was it's been an extremely successful company by almost any measure.
We started in the depths of the 2008 recession in the United States. So at this time, everything had crashed. Everything had fallen apart, and nobody was lending. A lot of people were homeless. My friend Bob was living in the back of his car. I mean, there were a bunch of people suffering, and I knew some of them. And when I talked to my business partner about the climate, he and I both agreed that this was a great time to start something new. It turns out that in periods of chaos, in periods of great disruption, there is an acceptance of new ideas. And one of the things that I didn't discuss in the speech was how radical it is to get a major employer to accept somebody who doesn't have a degree. I sort of glossed over that because I had, well, actually, all those AV problems that I didn't know what time was. But let me give you an example. The firms that we're talking about have very, very strict policies about who they will hire and who they will not hire. And those, there's an entire division, it's called Human Resources, that enforces those policies. And what we had to do was to break through those habits. And the reason we were able to break through was because right now there is such a shortage of talented programmers in the United States that I was able to call the CEOs of these companies and get them to agree to try something new. And then the CEOs would go down to the HR departments and say, you need to try this at least once. Well, once they try it once and it works, then they keep going. But it was the ability to get that change initiated that was critical. And the reason we were successful in getting that was because those companies are all suffering. They're all getting their asses kicked. And as a result of that, they're open to new ideas. So yes, you have a crisis here in Brazil, and I don't pretend to know what that means, but I do know something. One, there are a hell of a lot of people at this conference, okay?
Sure.
So you're all doing something. And secondly, in times of disruption, that's when new models evolve. And though I can't prescribe any sort of specifics, I can say that I guarantee that in this room, in this city, and certainly in this country, there are thousands of great ideas that will be given a chance because of this crisis. And not necessarily as a response to the crisis. Maybe you've been sitting on a great idea for 5 years. And then there's some dislocation or disruption, and you get the chance now to pursue it. So not to be Pollyanna-ish, I don't know how that translates. Yeah. But it's actually a very good time for innovation, right after chaos.
Muito bem. Bom, eu vou pedir para a tradutora complementar, mas assim, na verdade, eu acredito que até a maioria aqui tenha compreendido o que ele falou, mas de fato ele está reforçando o quanto a gente pode aproveitar essa oportunidade que a gente está tendo para transformar esse caos num grande fomento para a renovação, para melhorar e tudo mais. Essencial, se você quiser complementar, e já preparem as próximas perguntas que eu vou passar o microfone.
Bem, eu não...
Você quer uma pergunta, né? Ela está me dizendo que esse microfone não está funcionando. Alô? Esse está? Isso. Tem alguma coisa além que você poderia complementar importante?
Sim, que em momentos de crise são momentos de oportunidade, não é? No caso que eu ilustrei aqui dentro na sessão, todas aquelas empresas, todos aqueles empregadores com quem eu falei, tinham políticas muito rígidas de contratação. Porém, todos eles enfrentavam problemas. Eles tinham uma escassez de programadores, então eu tive que ligar para cada CEO. Cada um deles, então, falou com o seu diretor de RH e falou, tenta uma vez uma dessas pessoas. E deu certo. Então, bastava que uma contratação acontecesse para iniciar uma mudança. E o início dessa mudança que foi crítico. Na época que eu comecei a Square, nós passávamos por uma crise também. Foi em 2008. Foi quando me ocorreu que aquele era o momento. Tinha gente, tudo estava desmoronando. Tinha gente, meu amigo Bob dormindo no carro, as pessoas sem teto. Era o momento de fazer uma mudança. Na crise que o Brasil está passando agora, também tem muita gente com dificuldade, mas olha quanta gente nessa reunião, nessa sala. Então, em momentos de crise, são os momentos em que surgem os novos modelos. Eu não vou ser específico em relação à crise do Brasil, porque eu não a conheço a fundo. Mas nessa sala, nessa cidade, nesse país, existem grandes ideias. Às vezes, uma grande ideia que já existe há 5 anos e ficou lá numa gaveta. Esse é o momento dela aparecer. Não é querer ser Poliana. É uma questão que, em tempo de crise, é um bom tempo para inovação.
Muito bom. Eu vou agora abrir a pergunta para a plateia. Estou vendo que vocês já estão animados para perguntar. O microfone, por favor, se apresente. Oi. Como você quiser, você pode perguntar em português, eu acho que fica mais fácil para a maioria, ela traduz para ele, mas fica à vontade também.
Olá, Jim. Hello.
Aqui pode.
Nós temos uma empresa que oferta educação à distância, através da internet. E eu queria saber qual a sua visão sobre esse mercado, tanto nos Estados Unidos, como de uma forma geral, no todo.
Eu gostaria só de complementar uma coisa que acho que é importante para o Jim poder avaliar. Assim, as universidades brasileiras, muitas também estão oferecendo gratuitamente, estão dentro do Coursera, assim como outras universidades estrangeiras, Harvard, que você citou, ou outras universidades brasileiras, a USP, também fornecem o ensino à distância. Então, é uma coisa que está em expansão aqui no Brasil. Acho importante dar essa noção a ele de como é que nós estamos, né?
I believe that online education is a absolutely fundamental shift in the way knowledge is delivered. And there are a couple of huge things. First of all, we have always been constrained by the campus. So the first... Should I use this? Stereo again. Okay. We have always been constrained by the campus. And originally, education was apprenticeships. It was one-on-one. And then, as we started to scale education, we realized that we could get one knowledgeable person and surround them with as many people as they could fit in the room. So however many people we fit in that room, that's the old model, right? This is the new model, okay? This is being recorded, can be saved, can be replayed, can be rewatched. And because we have broken the constraints of the physical campus, we also have broken the inefficiencies of multiple physical campuses. So why should we all not be studying chemistry from the world's best or one of the world's best, pick the 10 best chemistry professors? So that's now possible. And the online model has given us that huge advantage. The second advantage, of course, is that it's potentially free. It's potentially, if not free, it is so radically cheaper than traditional education that it really opens up tremendously new possibilities. So LaunchCode is built on this idea that we can deliver this content to millions of people, knowing that hundreds of thousands of them will try and tens of thousands of them will pass. So we're still losing, you know, 10x at each juncture, but because we can scale up so radically, it doesn't matter. So that's another advantage of online education. The third thing that's super important is the idea of the flipped classroom. So the flipped classroom is where you watch the lecture by yourself, and then you come together with students to study together and solve problems together and work collaboratively. And that's, again, a fundamental shift in the way education was provided, because traditional classrooms, the lecture is done in group, and then you go home and do your homework by yourself. But imagine if you could start to work with others, because, like, what do you do when you're in the real world? Like, how many people get hired then say, oh, here's your corner? People don't even have offices anymore, right? So the contextual appropriateness of online education, I think, fits the world better. So it's got three huge advantages. Those are independent, but together, they're going to lead to, well, we're already seeing the revolution. Now, it's bad news if you own a college, right? If that model is what you're planning to do, you're in some trouble. But the benefits of having world-class, nearly free education that's more contextually appropriate is huge. So, yeah, good question.
Go ahead. Eu vou pedir para a nossa tradutora, porque ele colocou tantas coisas e ela vai pontualmente passar para a nossa reflexão. Por favor.
Bem, eu acredito que a educação à distância tem trazido uma mudança fundamental ao sistema educacional como um todo. Porque, tradicionalmente, a educação tinha alguns elementos que nos limitavam muito. O primeiro era a limitação de um campus físico. Não é? Antigamente, você tinha a educação no modelo aprendiz. Era de um para um, mestre e o aprendiz. Depois isso evoluiu em escala e a gente percebeu que se a gente encontrasse uma pessoa que tivesse conhecimento, ela podia ensinar para vários. Modelo de um para muitos. Hoje em dia, esse é o novo modelo. Essa palestra, essa sessão de perguntas está sendo gravada. Ela vai poder ser assistida quantas vezes for necessário. Então, esse é o novo modelo, que elimina essa ineficiência de você ter o que era necessário antes, múltiplos campos de uma universidade. Então, online é uma enorme vantagem. A segunda limitação que nós agora superamos com a educação à distância é a questão de que ela é gratuita ou potencialmente muito mais barata do que o modelo tradicional. No Launch Code, nós temos milhares de pessoas que fazem o curso. Algumas milhares se formam. A gente sempre tem algumas que se perdem no caminho. Então, nesse modelo de educação à distância, nós temos o que nós chamamos de sistema de sala de aula invertido. Na sala de aula tradicional, você tem professor, dá aula, o aluno vai para casa e faz o dever de casa, a lição de casa. Nesse modelo invertido, você tem o conteúdo online e as pessoas se reúnem, fazem grupos de estudo para trabalhar de uma forma colaborativa. É uma mudança fundamental no sistema, que na realidade, no mundo real, é assim que se trabalha. Ninguém chega, vai para uma sala de trabalho, recebe uma lição e vai fazer o dever de casa. Você tem que trabalhar já de uma forma colaborativa. Aliás, hoje em dia as pessoas nem mais têm sala, nem mais têm escritórios. A má notícia disso aí é se você é dono da universidade, porque a verdade é que os benefícios são tão grandes com a educação à distância que ela vai cada vez mais se disseminar.
Que ótimo, né? Mas ele coloca um desafio a mais, né? Mal para para quem está pensando de uma maneira muito estreita, mas para quem está pensando de uma maneira ampla, quanta coisa se abre. Eu vou abrir para mais perguntas da plateia. Tem uma pessoa aqui, depois eu peço a você, se apresenta, tá? E a empresa, para a gente também conhecer você um pouco mais.
Hi, Jim. Hello. I'm Karina. I work from iTech. Okay. And we resell furniture from Herman Miller, Fitz Hansen, and USM. And we think that on our market, we have the problem of the rules, fiscal rules of the Brazil. And you are told the problem when the rules is the company rules. And we have to break the rules and make it easy to get innovation. But when the problem is the fiscal rules and it's Brazilian rules, and how we can change, how can we be creative when we have difficulties from the government?
So the government is causing the problem?
Yes.
Yeah, don't feel special. Yeah, don't feel special. Look, and I've said this a lot. If one of the things that I think I see a lot is this sort of governmental reasoning. They say, well, we have this solution to this problem, and the government is a logical place to implement this solution. But again, it's almost a power series. If you give a dollar to an individual and you say, go buy something with this, they will get a dollar's value from that. If you give that dollar to a company and say, go spend that, they'll get 70 or 80 cents value out of it. You give it to a nonprofit, they'll get 50 cents. And you give it to a government, they'll get 10 cents of value. And we see this again and again and again. Governments are very inefficient at sort of implementing solutions. The rules that you're speaking of, I'm not familiar with. But hopefully they're consistent, okay? The biggest problem is when rules are inconsistent. If they're consistent for long enough, people find systems and work around them. It's when those rules are constantly in flux. And what happens is, through very good intention, well-meaning people decide that they're going to get into government and change things. And then they get in and implement their new set of good ideas. Even if they're good ideas, a lot of times the inefficiency of the way governments have to spend money and have to implement rules and have to be accountable and have to be auditable and have to be reelectable, and you get the idea. All of these things compound to make it incredibly inefficient, and so the change is extremely expensive. And I think one of the problems that we have in government is bad economics. In other words, our government officials, they're not corrupt, they're not incompetent. I mean, some of them are. And I'm sure you guys know a few. But in general, they're good people who really want to work and solve problems, but they're too optimistic about their abilities to solve those problems, and they don't understand the cost of their actions. So if you're suffering from too much rules, what I would suggest is ask your government to have a little more faith and a little less regulation. In general, that's a good way. But at the very least, to be consistent over time. You know, innovation is not government's strong suit. So that's the last place I'd push for a radical change. As a matter of fact, when President Obama stood up and said that he wanted to, you know, give $100 million to organizations like ours, I freaked out, because we've done what we've done in there for less than $1 million. You know, it was, LaunchCode was started, I've spent $40,000 starting this thing. That's how much it took. But you throw $100 million at a problem, and all of a sudden all the scumbags show up. In our case, it's the University of Phoenix. I don't know if you guys have those. Hopefully you don't. But we have this educator in the United States that just takes people's money, gives them terrible education, but they have great marketing and great sales, and they're really good at preying on people's insecurities. And when the government makes money available, they immediately target those programs and just exploit these people. And I was worried when the president said he had $100 million that he wanted to sort of allocate to our type of solution, that he would screw everything up, because we'd get all the dirtbags in there, and then we wouldn't have a solution anymore. We just have, you know, sort of predatory education.
Okay, vamos deixá-la traduzir. Jim, our system in universities are totally different from the U.S. We don't have all those famous universities competing from students. Ok, eu vou pedir uma coisa, gente, só para facilitar a compreensão de todos. As próximas perguntas, se vocês puderem formular em português, acho que a gente tem uma percepção melhor. E agora eu vou pedir para a nossa tradutora, se você puder dar uma sintetizada na hora de traduzir também, para a gente abrir mais. Faça o seu possível, querida. Mas assim, eu sei que tem muita coisa boa aí.
Bom,
é contigo.
O governo não é só no Brasil, né? Então, uma coisa que eu repito muito é que a mentalidade do governo, né? Se você dá $1 para uma pessoa, a pessoa vai e compra $1 em valor. Se for $1 para uma companhia, ela vai ter 70, 80 centavos daquele dólar em valor. Uma entidade sem fins lucrativos, 50 centavos de dólar de valor. O governo vai ser 10 centavos. O governo é ineficiente na implementação de soluções. Eu não conheço as regras daqui, tá? Eu só posso esperar que haja uma certa consistência nessas regras fiscais que você menciona, porque se há consistência, a gente sempre encontra uma forma de contornar essas regras. As pessoas do governo, elas não são corruptas, quer dizer, algumas até são, bom, mas em geral são pessoas boas, que têm boas ideias, elas entram para o governo com boas ideias, só que quando elas chegam lá, na hora de implementar, tem tanta regra, tem tanta obrigação de transparência, de prestação de contas, a vontade de se reeleger, que tudo isso cria uma grande ineficiência nos governos. Então, a mudança é uma coisa que custa muito caro. Em geral, o governo tem uma má economia, bad economics, né? E, em geral, como eu dizia, as pessoas são boas, elas só não entendem o custo de suas ações. Então, a sugestão que o nosso mercado, as nossas empresas, abordem o governo pedindo que o governo tenha um pouco mais de fé, um pouquinho menos de regulamentação. E, se isso não for possível, que pelo menos as regras sejam consistentes.
Ótimo.
Inovação não é o forte do governo. Tem mais ainda.
Ah, tem mais um pouquinho?
Tem
vai
mais.
Lá, vai lá.
Quando o presidente Obama, eu disse, ofereceu 100 milhões para a nossa organização, para organizações como as nossas, eu dei uma pirada na hora. Fiquei meio aflito, com medo, porque nós tínhamos feito tudo o que nós tínhamos feito com quase que, um pouquinho menos que $1 milhão. Eu mesmo coloquei $40 mil de investimento nessa iniciativa. E quando tem muito dinheiro, logo aparecem os abutres, não é? E lá a gente também tem. Chama-se Universidade de Phoenix, Phoenix, University of Phoenix. Eles pegam o dinheiro, eles dão uma educação de péssima qualidade, só que eles têm um super marketing, então eles exploram as pessoas. O meu medo era justamente que essas verbas todas acabassem indo parar na mão desses abutres, que afinal não aconteceu.
All right.
Muito bom. Não, tá certo, ela tem razão. Ela anota ipsis litteris, é mais fácil ela ler. Não vou te pedir mais para traduzir, para reduzir a tradução. Eu tenho mais uma pergunta ali, se apresenta, por favor, e pode fazer sua pergunta.
Ok. Em inglês ou português?
Português, eu acho que facilita para todos.
Ok. Meu nome é Alexandre Santos, sou executivo de TI. Minha pergunta seria sobre o momento de criação da empresa.
Ok.
Da Square. Não perguntei ainda, estou só
respondendo. Okay.
Minha pergunta seria sobre a criação da empresa, né, da Square. Uhum. Como foi esse momento para vocês, né, de criação da empresa? Né? Como é que a ideia saiu do papel, né, e o que você sentiu no seu coração, a certeza de que a sua ideia valia a pena? E se a ideia seria uma empresa for profit, né, desde o começo, né, visando lucros. E a segunda parte da pergunta seria nos tempos atuais, né, seria sobre transformação digital. O que você pensa sobre a transformação digital para as empresas gigantes que temos hoje, né, atualmente, que tem uma resistência muito grande, né, com a transformação digital, né, de rever os seus negócios, né, rever os seus processos, né, as estruturas, né, e quão competitivas você acha que as empresas têm comparando com as novas startups que estão surgindo?
Wow. Okay. So, yeah, I'm going to answer both questions, but I'm going to answer them in reverse order. So the first question was on digital transformation of giant organizations. And generally, and if you saw Malcolm Gladwell, he spoke about this morning, as you're big, the game changes. And even right now, as I've watched my company grow from 2 people to 10 people to 100 people, now we have 1,000 people, then we are able to do different things. So when you got 1,000 people, you can throw tremendous amounts of resources at certain problems, but sometimes controlling those resources or directing them or motivating them is different. So everybody has a different set of advantages and disadvantages. So I haven't really said anything at this point. What I think is interesting, though, are the cultural advantages that certain organizations have. So I was super interested when Mario was telling me about his company's lack of structure and flat organization. And I think he should be giving the speech on this, because it's fascinating to see organizations thrive without hierarchy. But as far as digital transformation goes, two things. First of all, every big company employee has at least heard the message. Now, they may not be acting on that message. The two reasons I find most prevalent for them not acting is the reward structures at the company. So if a company is used to penalizing people who fail, then people will try to do things that they know will work. So that creates a conservative attitude. The second thing is that within certain industries, conservatism is a prerequisite. And these industries are now being attacked. So the great example is financial technologies. So a financial technology company, at its very core, has to be good at not having their money stolen. Like, that's what they do. That's why the bank shows a picture of that big vault. They show you that because they want you to believe your money is safe. And if they're not innovative, But everybody who is innovative has their money stolen. They're the best bank. So in industries that are built on qualities like accountability, good accounting practices, auditability, such as banking, you tend to evolve these cultures, complete cultures, where everybody in the culture is extremely conservative by their nature. And those cultures work really well until they come up against a disruptive change, like the fact that people are starting to bank from mobile phones, which are essentially software devices, as opposed to financial service devices. Not much you can do about the culture in an institution like that. I've never seen that corrected. That's one of those ones where, you know, it's just in your DNA. Maybe you should translate that answer since it's long.
Yeah, it's good.
Permite para eu já traduzir essa parte que é mais longa, né? Começando com a segunda pergunta, que era sobre a transformação digital em empresas gigantes, né? Malcolm Gladwell falou sobre isso hoje de manhã. É, você começa pequeno, mas à medida que você vai crescendo, as regras do jogo para você mudam, né? Na nossa empresa foi assim, eram duas pessoas, aumentou para 10, depois para 100, e hoje em dia são 1.000. Então, claro que com 1.000 pessoas você tem muito mais recursos que você pode usar para resolver problemas. Por outro lado, como motivar 1.000 pessoas, né? Muda totalmente o conjunto de dificuldades. Então, é bem interessante porque existem algumas vantagens culturais. O Mário, hoje, me falava sobre a Vagas, né? Sobre a estrutura que é flat, sem hierarquia. E, para mim, é fascinante ver como empresas assim prosperam. Talvez até o Mário devesse responder a sua pergunta. Mas, voltando à transformação digital... É, a gente tem aquele funcionário, né? Tem algumas empresas que tem aquele funcionário, ele já ouviu a mensagem, ele sabe qual é a visão, sabe qual é a mensagem da empresa, mas ele não vai lá e age. Por quê? Provavelmente porque a estrutura de recompensas não é adequada. Se a empresa tem a mentalidade de penalizar o erro, então a pessoa só vai realmente fazer aquilo que ela tem certeza que vai dar certo. Então, é o conservadorismo. Em alguns setores, o conservadorismo é fundamental, né? Você pega, por exemplo, uma companhia de tecnologia financeira. Um banco, por exemplo, o mais importante para ele é saber que o dinheiro não vai ser roubado. Então, todas as agências têm lá aquela foto do cofre para te passar aquela ideia que o seu dinheiro está lá e o seu dinheiro está seguro, né? Então, toda empresa que é regida por transparência, prestação de contas, tem que poder ser auditada, ela vai ser conservadora por natureza, até que aconteça uma mudança de ruptura. Então, hoje, de repente, quando você pode fazer todo um sistema de pagamento utilizando um smartphone... Você não está mais falando de dispositivos de pagamento, você está falando de dispositivos de software. Então, muda totalmente essa mentalidade.
Okay, now to the first question you asked. And the reason I'm answering the first question second is because the fact that you answered, or that you asked the first question is actually somewhat of an answer to the second one, and I'll explain why. You said you were from a larger company. And I can tell from the way you asked the first question, some of the way you think, because his first question was very interesting. And this is a good question. How did you know, when did you know that Square was going to be successful? When did you have this idea and get validation of it? And buried in that question is this idea that you can know. There's this assumption that if you're going to do something, it would be nice to know in advance if it's going to work. And I agree with you. I wish I could have known. And it would be very impressive for me to stand up here and tell you that I knew that it was going to work as well as it has. I did not. Jack did not. Jack and I made a bet when we started the company that we would meet a year from the day we launched the company and celebrate with either champagne if we were successful or hot dogs from a street vendor if we were not. And that was the only agreement that we had starting, because literally we were doing something that had never been done before. We were giving credit card processing power to people who had never had it before. And we were told by some very, very smart people all sorts of things that would kill us. And we had no reason to dispute them because, well, it had never been done before, and they were very, very smart people. And so there's no way, well, maybe there's a way to know. I've never had that. I've always approached these things with just a tremendous amount of humility realizing that you're going to try, if you're trying something new, if you really, you'll know it's new if it is so damn uncomfortable that you can't even discuss it with people around you. They just don't get it. They just don't understand. And the only thing I can say as a way to make that a little more bearable is that every person I know who truly does something innovative feels that way at the beginning, because you don't get that validation. Or at least I've never seen it, and I've never met anybody who's done it who I don't think is just lying. You know? So, you know, if you have an idea and you think it's revolutionary, you will most likely have to pursue that by yourself for a long time, even at a big company. But the value of that is that eventually you get invited to speak at groups like this. So thank you very much.
Vou passar a palavra para a nossa tradutora.
Responder. Essa foi a sua primeira pergunta. A razão de eu ter respondido a segunda pergunta antes é que, de certa forma, na sua pergunta já estava embutido um pouquinho da resposta da primeira, né? Do jeito que você perguntou, meio que já sei o que você está pensando, porque você perguntou sobre a Square, quando que a gente sentiu que realmente a coisa ia dar certo, que a Square ia ter sucesso. A verdade é que a gente não sabia, né? Você tem uma ideia inovadora, e você não tem como saber. Você não sabe se vai dar certo. É uma coisa... O Jack e eu, nós fizemos uma aposta, inclusive, no dia que a gente começou o negócio. A gente falou, daqui a um ano a gente vai se encontrar e a gente vai celebrar. Ou com champanhe, se tiver sucesso, ou então comendo cachorro quente na esquina, se tiver fracassado. Né? Porque, na verdade, era uma coisa totalmente inédita. A gente estava dando poder de processamento de cartão de crédito para pessoas que nunca tinham feito aquilo antes. Podia ter dado tudo errado. Então, é uma aposta. Né? E você perguntou quanto que eu sabia. Eu nunca soube. No fundo, a gente nunca sabe. Nesse tipo de situação, eu sempre me encho de humildade. Porque se é uma coisa nova, gera um certo desconforto. É difícil você falar daquela ideia para os outros, porque as pessoas não têm a menor ideia do que você está falando. Então, se você tem uma ideia inovadora, se você sente que aquilo é inovação, você vai se sentir desse jeito, meio que sozinho, porque você não tem validação de ninguém para aquela sua ideia. Então, você vai trabalhar sozinho, talvez por um bom tempo, mesmo numa grande empresa, até ver o que vai acontecer.
Muito bom, gente. Ótimo. Eu agradeço a pergunta de todos. Nós temos que liberar o Jim, porque ele tem outro compromisso agora na sequência, então a gente tem que liberá-lo. Já em nome da Vagas, eu agradeço muito a apresentação do Jim, a palestra, as perguntas da plateia. Então, vamos aplaudi-lo e agradecer mais uma vez. Aplausos.